I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
We need a motion for approval of minutes from previous meeting.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Madam Chairman, may I make a motion to suspend the rules, take up item 9 at this time, which is a public hearing on presentation of proposed FY 2017 budget.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Public hearings.
Being commissioners and members of the public that will be watching this, it's our budget preparation for FY 17. Again, to review what the essential services of the Portsmouth Fire Department are, everything from fire protection, emergency medical, which are highly visible, to our hazard material and disaster response, marine and waterfront response, fire prevention and inspection. We also are the lead agency in emergency management for the city, and we respond to a number of community services. This past year, we've reviewed our goals and objectives, and I'd like to present them. They're consistent with what we did last year. And that is, the first one is department will maintain and strengthen reliable delivery of essential emergency and non-emergency services. And we have these objectives, and a key one, of course, is our response to equally respond across the city within 8 minutes, 90% of the time. We also look at deploying our apparatus, distribute our personnel and our fire stations, again, for equal coverage, and leverage available technology and research opportunities to improve the department's ability to provide essential services. Next goal is the department will promote the safety of employees and the community through comprehensive education training. Of course, objectives that meet this goal: encourage employee health, safety, wellness, and fitness through education prevention programs, maintain effective training programs and state-of-the-art equipment, and implement fire prevention and public education initiatives that focus on the city's high-risk population. Next goal, we will minimize the risk of life and property loss through proactive planning, education, enforcement of safe practices. And this is when we get into the fire prevention and education realm of the department. And this year's been kind of busy, but the conduct plans review on 100% of construction and renovation projects, implement fire and injury prevention initiatives through public education, and ensure compliance with applicable fire and life safety laws, codes, and standards through annual inspections of 100% of the city's place of assembly occupancies. And last, the department will provide effective, efficient, and customer-centered services. We achieve this by promoting opportunities to receive honest input and feedback from citizens, business owners, and elected officials on operations of the department, respond to 100% of all concerns related to life safety hazards within 2 business days of receipt, maintain a 90% customer satisfaction level, and identify process improvements and implement cost-saving changes. For this past year, calendar year, we respond to a total of 4,639 incidents. That's about 6% more than we were last year at 4,363. And you can see the breakdown, the fire-related incidents. Specifically, we're 2,707, up just under 200 from last year. And EMS-related services, again, up about 200 calls, 3,316 versus 3,127. One of the areas that we like to track, the fire department does bring in revenues through our ambulance collections for services rendered. You can see here, in over the last 5 years, we've had a steady increase in our net revenues. This is not gross. And from last year to this year, a substantial growth. So for FY 15, we brought in $825,642. And again, that's not put back into our budget. It goes in the city's general fund. But I think it's important that we account for this. And our collection rate is comparable to other communities of similar size and demographics, and we're about 77.8% collection rate over the last 5 years. I'll go to this thing. Position summary, as we're proposing for FY 17, there is no change in net full-time positions, nor are there any net changes in our part-time positions. So for full-time, we'll see 61 full-time positions, and part-time positions will still be at 3. So for our budget request for FY 17, we were given the guideline of 3% increase. What we're looking at is approximately $8.2 million budget, represents about $247,000 increase, or again, 3% increase over FY 16. The effects on the budget specifically are step increases, New Hampshire retirement increases, health insurance, telephone services, and just to clarify on that, the city phone system, we were under the general government, and we're not paying the full price for our phone system in all fire departments, and that's been transferred over us this upcoming year. So now that's about a $15,000 increase. What this budget does, it maintains current level of service, staffing, stations, and resources. It does not add any additional resources to the department. It does not change stations or staffing models. And it does not take into account any COLA or new collective bargaining agreements for firefighters and officers. That the city would identify in a separate fund, and at such time we would get that. Now, there are some supplemental considerations that are not included in the proposal as it is right now. This was based on evaluation of our current services. Also, last year we completed the self-assessment on department operations. And a number of areas, especially those that affect the delivery of essential services in the city, for fire protection, EMS, and fire prevention, and other non-emergency services, was to increase or potentially look at the increase of staffing and prevention services. This is a result of approximately 1.5 million or 1.5 million square foot of increased occupancies, square footage in the city over the last 5 years. Also, the demographics of the community, where we have an aging community and demands on ambulance and fire services alike there's an increased demand for those. We also look at the place of assembly in the buildings. We have a strong economy. What we're seeing is a significant growth in the residential and commercial aspects of the city. I know even for this year, the inspection department in the city is projecting over the next couple of years 500 to 800 new residential properties, and there's a number of large properties that are being constructed or planned for being construction. All of these are putting a stress on the department. We're seeing an increase in simultaneous calls. It used to be about 15%, and last year we were about 25%. We have not projected that this year, but we're doing the same services with the same amount of people that we were 15, 20 years ago, but the demands are increasing with, again, the development, the demographics, and the request for the complexity of the calls we're going to. As you can see, if we were to add one additional firefighter per shift, it would be about $230,000 or 2.64% above the 3% threshold. This would allow us to staff the department at 14 all the time, but have a maximum shift staffing of 15. Also, we look at our EMS services. We have 70% of our run volume is attributed to EMS-related calls. Over the last couple of years with the Affordable Care Act, changes in certification requirements and education requirements, standard cares and protocols, there would be some benefit of having a dedicated officer that was given the task of monitoring and managing the EMS services under a deputy or the chief. Right now, we're sharing this across chief officers and company officers as administrative duties. That one position would be about $85,000, or just under a percent, in addition to the 3%. And we're also looking at considering a part-time fire prevention officer. Currently, we have a deputy fire chief and a fire prevention officer. There's a demand with the development plans reviews, place of assembly inspections. One of the areas that we're missing a lot of times is the public education component, in that the goal of targeting our high-risk populations. We're also trying to implement a program of inspecting multi-unit buildings over three occupants or three residences, and that's going to take manpower. So one of the initial thoughts was to consider a part-time position that would do prevention, and that's about $44,000, or 0.5%. So all these three options, if we were to do them collectively, would bring our request significantly over the 3% guidelines that were presented. You're looking at close to 7% if we were to do that. I think as we move forward in the next couple weeks, we're investigating opportunities. Some of these would be connected to collective bargaining, and it is challenging with not having settled contracts, and they're going into their third year of not being settled, that to implement new measures or look at opportunities are going to be more challenging if we don't even have a basic contract signed with both unions. So that will have an impact as we consider these options. But as it stands right now, we will be able to operate at the 3% guidelines. And if there are any questions, I can answer them from the commission or members of the public.
Addition of either the EMS officer or the firefighter, is that an additional ambulance, an additional vehicle, or is it just a
At full staffing, if there are no shift vacancies, that would give us 15, so that puts us in a position to staff the third ambulance as needed. If we're at a 14 staffing, at least it puts more manpower on the call. So as noted in the paper this past week, it is a challenge when a complex building or complex incident requires more staffing to manage it than a simple residential call, simple medical. So I think with that number, we'd be able to distribute and deploy personnel appropriately and minimize the instance where we don't have sufficient staff to respond to calls.
A question regarding the EMS officer that you're speaking of. What is the true operating title, and what would the official duties be, and would that person be would continue to be on the firefighting roster as well?
As it's envisioned, it would be a company officer, either a lieutenant or captain level. They would have administrative duties solely as the EMS officer, recognized by the state as our EMS officer for the service, be responsible for EMS training, education, recertifications, continuing education, development of new technologies, and implementing new procedures. At this point, I'm in discussions with the officers' union of what would this look like, and is there a possibility that they could be assigned to day shifts and cover day vacancies as they came up, as long as it could balance with the administrative duties of the position. So I see it as a company-level officer under the 4039 or the officer's contract, but we'd have to look at some. Right now, the contract does not have any provision for that position. Any other questions?
Yeah, one other one. Are we currently seeing any increase in the response times at all, or do we know based on our simultaneous calls, or is it an emerging risk that we're trying to get in front of?
I see it as both. As we track our 90% response goal of 8 minutes or less, that has been elevated a little bit over the last couple of years, because our initial goal about 7 or 8 years ago was 7 minutes or less. Unfortunately, with the call volume, the types of calls, with construction and changes in the city infrastructure about getting around in transportation infrastructure, we're really tracking more 8 minutes and above. And as we evaluate that as we move forward, I see that additional staffing will allow us to do better at that. If we can deploy units and keep them in their districts so they're not traveling across districts backing up other calls, I think we'll get back down to the 7 minutes. It's a good measure, but it seems that it's insurmountable right now that we can't go back down to 7 minutes.
Yeah, and it was one of our goals, right, to have that reduced response time so it increased our level of service.
And we also are, over the course of this year, we'll come up with a standard cover document that explains a little more in depth about the risks that we have in the city as far as all types of incidents that we respond to, what is the best practice deployment, and what are our expected outcomes by those deployments. So we'll present that hopefully before the end of this fiscal year, so that the public, elected officials, can see what we need to, what are our goals in deployment, that it's not an arbitrary number, but it's based on what tasks need to be accomplished, how many people need to be there to accomplish it, and what time frame, and what is the ultimate outcome by deploying that in that means.
A question related to the same subject would be, how much of the extended response time could be just a sheer amount of volume of traffic that we have on Lafayette Road, Maplewood, Woodbury, downtown. It's ridiculous in the summertime, as we all know. And I'm not complaining about it. I like it, but it's causing us a problem, I think.
If we had a year that we didn't have a significant construction project, either bridges, roadways, sewer lines, we could compare that.
Yeah.
But since we've been collecting the data, there's been some large or complex construction project on our roadways. As we know, the past year we had bridges. Before that, we had the intersection at Lafayette Road and the bypass.
Yeah.
We've had major construction along Middle Street with pipelines, gas lines, sewer systems. So if we had a year with that we could compare that had no construction, I could give you a clearer number, but I have to believe that some of that is attributed to that. And that also has effect when downtown is our busiest district. That's a more concentration of calls. So as they get busier and can't cover the calls, this station or station three have to respond. So that is an increased response time, especially if they have multiple calls downtown or tied up with a evacuation or an evaluation of a condition at a hotel or a large commercial building downtown or one of our senior housing. If that takes time and they can't clear and mitigate the problem, that's where we see an increase of overlap calls when they can't clear and another out-of-district unit has to cover.
I think looking at the capital improvement program, you're not going to see a year without construction for quite a few years. I think it's continuous now.
And we've looked at other, and we talk about goals in technology and leveraging technology. We've tried to decrease our response times by a number of measures. One of them is we have iPads in every vehicle that has real-time mapping, location of the incident, hydrants, and information on occupancies. So we're hoping that would start to decrease our response times and also allow us to mitigate the problem faster if we know some of the protection systems, accesses in different buildings already. We have an Opticom system or a preemption system on our fire apparatus, so we can get through the intersections quicker. We've also implemented a pre-alert in the stations so that we have a 15-second heads up so our turnout times can be decreased. And all these measures at the end of the story still aren't decreasing our response times. So again, I think that it's at some point the current resources and deployment model are going to have to be beefed up in the city. And the city's growing. It's the population may be less than it was when the Air Force Base was open, but the demographics are starting to change. The layout of the city's changed. The downtown's changed. Commercial, industrial, tourist, that is bringing a lot more people and a lot more complex incidents to the city. So,
not to confuse the issue, but are the EMS calls response times separated, and are they continuing to rise, or is it just when you have a truck leaving?
Right now, the EMS calls are separate.
And those times, have they elevated?
And they've gone up about a minute over the last 5 to 7 years. And again, that requires us to look at our deployment model, and we're continually implementing measures, resources allocations on certain types of calls so that we can free up pieces earlier or send the right amount of pieces and resources to the call. So that we've been doing that all along, and I think we're getting to a point where all those efficiencies that we've been trying to employ are maximized, and we're going to have to look at other measures. And I think that's why we start talking about at the end of the story, we need resources. We need personnel to start mitigating these calls. Anything else? Anything for the public? All right. That's all I have for our report.
Thank you, Chief.
Public comment session.
You motion to that? Just move
into. No, just move into.
Move into our public comment session. Nobody's
wishing to speak.
Nobody's wishing to speak. Recognition of groups or individuals?
None.
Fire Chief Report 16012 through 16015.
Motion to approve, receive the Chief Reports 16-2 to 16-05.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Your first report, you'll see our service activity and safety message for January of this year. Just to remind you, our activities, we track it calendar year, which is how the reporting system works. So you'll see it as calendar year. So it looks like it reset. Total incident activity for January was 361. We had 93 fire and related service calls and 268 ambulance calls. We always try to make a incident of interest or note, and we have three here to note for the month of January. One was on the 19th. We had a motor vehicle crash rollover at Islington Street and Vine Street. It was a single vehicle rollover and struck a utility pole. Electrical wires were involved, and the driver was extricated using hydraulic rescue tools and transported to Portsmouth Regional Hospital with minor injuries. Unique to that incident was the fact that the two engines and an ambulance were working in a extremely hazardous environment, precarious environment, because of the power lines, and they made a successful extrication, and no other further injuries occurred. Next incident was on the 27th, another motor vehicle accident rollover that was in the area of 250 Elwin Road. It was a single vehicle rollover. There were two occupants, and it appears that the driver had a medical event while driving. Passenger was not injured, and the driver was transported to Portsmouth Regional Hospital in critical condition. That there was no trauma, but the medical condition was extremely serious. And the last one was on the 30th. We had a vehicle fire in front of 218 Melbourne Street. There was a vehicle parked in the street fully involved upon the arrival of Engine 1 and Ambulance 1. There were no exposures, and it took just under 10 minutes to control the fire. We also, in our activity, try to put out a safety message, and this has been put in the paper. And I think it's important, although we haven't been we've been experiencing mild weather so far, we like to encourage all our residents to be prepared for weather-related emergencies, including power outages. So planning ahead will go a long way to minimize the impact on the residents, their families. And what we look and we encourage is that people stock food that needs no cooking or refrigeration and water in clean containers. Ensure that their cell phones are fully charged. And keep an up-to-date emergency kit that includes battery-operated or crank flashlights, weather radios. They even have chargers now and lamps. We encourage a first aid kit. And if you take extra medicines because you can't get to the pharmacy or get out of your house, that you have appropriate extra medicines. And that was submitted to the Portsmouth Herald this past week. On 013, the incident type and category breakdown for fire. Remind the commission and those at home that although we said there were just about 98 fire-related incidents, what we also look at is the total number of times the fire apparatus go out on calls, and that was about 196. 103 of those are for rescue calls, that is supporting the serious medical calls, the motor vehicle accidents, or when an ambulance is not available. So for fire incidents for the month, again, we did 196. I give you a breakdown of our fire districts breakdown, and you can see that our Station 1 district, which is downtown, and it was about 46% of our incidents occur in the downtown area. And then the following ones, you can see Station 2 district about 13%, Station 3 another 13%, and then smaller percentages. The Central Business District, which is the immediate downtown area, was another 7%. So really downtown is closer to 53% of our call volume. The incident types are listed here. Gives you the percentages and the maximum numbers. Medical assist, motor vehicle accidents are our highest responses, along with fire calls, whether they be building fire or other types of fires, gas leaks. And because we have a municipal alarm system, we're getting a lot of alarms. So you'll see that number is high, whether it be a smoke condition in a building or system malfunction. We don't seem that we get a lot of malicious false alarms, but because most of our buildings have an alarm system, we'll see a lot of calls for that. Any questions on either 013 so far or 012?
No.
No.
All right, I'll continue on our EMS call volume. 268 runs. We do provide EMS to the town of Newcastle, ambulance transport. We back up and assist Greenland, and we provide mutual aid to other towns such as Rye, Newington, and Stratham. And Portsmouth ambulance calls make about 95% of our responses. I did include runs by provider impression, or what was the evaluation of our crews upon arrival? And we can see again that higher numbers are in chest pain, other cardiovascular incidents, some behavioral disorders, and some form of traumatic injury, which could be a cut, broken bone, dislocation, or a head injury. I also added this one just so the commission could see this, is runs by location. Sometimes we're asked with the population, either the work population or the tourist population, where do most of our incidents occur? And about 48% of, almost 49% of our incidents happen at somebody's home or residence in the city. So the next highest would be a business, which is about 14.5%, and then the next one, street or highway, which is about 11%.
That's a very interesting set of circumstances there.
I think it demonstrates that, again, most of our incidents for ambulance are for residents. And because we have a significant roadway system, we have an interstate and a U.S. route, and we also have a number of businesses, bars, restaurants, that those would be, it would make sense that the remainder in there. We transport to Portsmouth Regional Hospital about, most of the time, and out of the 268 calls, so you see this, is about 25% of our requests for response do not require transport. So that would be that 26% of our calls not requiring transport.
Just out of curiosity, a transport two transports to Exeter would be because you were in Stratham or Greenland?
It could be, or the request was made from a patient in Portsmouth that their condition warranted or allowed for the extended transport. We try to transport within reason to the closest, most appropriate hospital. If the patient has a request to go to York, for example, as long as they're stable and it's appropriate, we'll do that. But if they are unstable or in serious condition, we'll always transport to the closest hospital. And that's Portsmouth Regional. We're fortunate that the hospital's in town. Any questions on?
No.
The ambulance report. Okay. 014 is our current budget. So FY16. As always, I bring you to two specific areas at the bottom. We're approximately 58% into the year, the budget year, and we're about 65% spent. Areas that are influencing our spending, some of them are things that we cannot control, but we have to account for. And two, that if you see in our salaries, workers' comp and disability, we've had a number of our employees on workers' comp and due to injuries on duty. One is still out from an injury at one of our fires on Stark Street. And disability is also when firefighters are injured off duty or they have a medical procedure. We've had a couple that have been out. We have one currently out with a knee issue that may be long-term. So when we fill their vacancy on the shift, we account for it out of the overtime or shift replacement out of workers' comp line or disability. So I don't want to confuse workers' comp with what our workers' comp payments are. This is filling those slots that are shift vacancies due to workers' comp or disability. Also, you'll see that our emergency recall is tracking a little high. One, it's the number of incidents we go to when we have to recall personnel. We've had it, and we know in October and December we had some significant fire events. Also, when we go mutual aid to another community. Also, out of the emergency recall line comes other shift replacement costs that don't fall under any other line. So military leave, when we have members in the military, comes out of that, and funeral leave. And we also have administrative leave that comes out of there. Other areas that are trending higher is the repairs to equipment and vehicle repairs. Vehicle repairs, fortunately, the state changed the inspection of all our apparatus to September. And when we do an inspection, if there are any deficiencies, we fix them. Usually it happens in March. So we believe that was more front-loaded. And also, there are other front-loaded costs that we usually pay up front, in, whether they be service contracts or some of the other lines we'll pay up front in the beginning of the year that come out of our budget. Right now, we're projected, if all things were to stay the same, about $14,000 in the red. I put out a memo to the commission. I put it out to the department that we have implemented some measures to start controlling the cost, and whether they be stabilizing different accounts, cutting back on different accounts. We usually track it based on current spending and then what have we done over the last couple of years or last year in that month. So you put those things together, it doesn't mean we're going to be short automatically, but we're trending that way. These are, we put in probably five or six measures to bring this down. We'll monitor those. If by March or April it starts to pick up again and we can't, those measures don't seem to work, then we'll have to implement more significant measures. And typically those start to get into salary lines or overtime lines, training and so forth. Any questions on 014?
Nope.
So this has already come down since our last meeting, so those corrective measures.
Right. Right.
And your balancing has already improved?
Yeah, so in January we're projected to be about 50,000 in the red, and we implemented those measures, now we're about 14. And we're still going to have the stress if we have long-term vacancies that reduce shift staffing, and that has to be covered by shift replacement with overtime to maintain our minimum staffing and deployment, then that's going to be a big draw on the budget.
Yeah. And March is probably really where we need to be trued up, because then we'd run out of runway to make it up.
Yes.
In the rest of the year.
Okay. Any other questions? Nope. We always add an overtime analysis report. Again, just to see where we spent about $36,000 in overtime. You can see that recall was about $4,000. But if you look specifically for the numbers that we have, earned time and disability or and workers' comp coverage for overtime or shift replacement, we spent almost $8,000, or about $7,600. We do also like to break down the recall account by that $4,000. And you can see that either holdover incidents that happen at shift change where the crew cannot leave work and they have to stay. New Year's Eve fireworks, honor guard for the city council inauguration. Shift coverage for some administrative leave. And then you can see we had a recall for a fire at State Street. We had mutual aid and we also to Exeter, and we also went mutual aid to Kittery.
New Year's Eve seems so long ago.
It does seem so long ago. Any questions on 015?
No.
All right.
Make a motion to approve items 16-12 through 16-15.
So moved.
All those
in
favor?
Favor.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Staff reports?
We have both deputies here. Start with Deputy Hines. Do you have a report? If you could just go up to the microphone there, that'd be great.
Madam Chairman, members of the Fire Commission. As usual, the Operations Training Division is busy. We're moving forward with a pretty rigorous captain and lieutenant's promotional process. It's very competitive and very challenging. All of our emergency medical service providers have to be licensed with the state of New Hampshire, so we're in the process of getting that done. Some of those licenses expire March 31st, or April 30th, excuse me. We tweaked our Emergency Medical Service Continuous Quality Improvement Committee. We've invested some more people into that and making it more diverse, actually one member from each group. So that's really started off really well. We've also hosted a RADF officer and a web EOC class here for other members around the state and some of our staff and our front office staff, and that went really well. So we're continuing to just keep moving forward. Any questions?
Deputy, could you just, the RADF, just explain to the commission what that is?
So within the Seabrook Station emergency response drills that we do here, we're within, Station 2 is within the 10-mile loop. One of the key players in that is a RADF officer who's responsible for the city of Portsmouth and all of its, really all of its residents and emergency workers and their exposure to radiation, what levels, where they move, what they can do, and tracking that all. It's a pretty challenging project. So we've now got three guys who I think are very well equipped to do that.
Any questions for the deputy?
No.
Thank you. Deputy Roediger?
Nothing to report.
Smooth.
All right, move on to old business.
None.
Presentation of written communications.
We received one letter. It's not in your agenda. This came in just on the 25th. It was, Dear Chief Achilles, on behalf of the Town of Newington Board of Fire Engineers and the Newington Fire Department, I'd like to express our sincere gratitude to your department for providing manpower and apparatus for the structure fire at 293 Little Bay Road on January 23rd. We appreciate your accommodating our request for help, and that was received from Andrew Head, Fire Chief in Newington. As you know, we also went to Newcastle.
Yeah. Busy weekend. New business?
None.
Anything for non-public?
No non-public.
Great. Guess we can adjourn.
Your favorite.
Can we make a motion to adjourn?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Yes.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.